introduce our distinguished speaker. I will not say distinguished guest because actually Dr. Xie is our colleague, or more precisely speaking, he is our colleague, but he is also our co-worker. So let me briefly introduce Professor Xie. He is our alumni. He graduated from our Yangming University School of Medicine. So he also received the award because he is our outstanding alumni. So, and now he is currently the director of Immunology Research Center of the NHRI, 国家卫生研究院。And he is also the distinguished investigator of Genomic Research Center of Academia Sinica, and also appointedly joined professor of Institute of Clinical Medicine. And recently, we also jointly appointed him as our professor of School of Medicine, College of Life Science, and also the Institute of Molecular Biology and Immunology. So now he has many titles, and if I remember, he is also adjunct professor of National Taiwan University, the Institute of Immunology. Okay. And Professor Xie received a lot of numerous awards. And I cannot tell you all of these awards, but I can just tell you some national, is well recognized national level award, like the Outstanding Research Award. This is NSTC or NSC, National Science Council, or National Science Technology, NSTC, 国科会。He received 3 times of this NSTC Outstanding Research Award. And he also received this MOE Outstanding Award, 教育部 Ministry of Education. This is 这个教育部 MOE Outstanding Research Award. And he also received a lot of these famous, like 李天德友阳基金会 and also 王明林 Award.These are very famous and very highly competitive. It's a peer-reviewed award. So now you know his research is very outstanding. And in addition to his research, he also has a lot of this, this kind of application. Recently, he is very interested in this kind of translational medicine. So he wants to apply his research to pharmaceutical company. So today maybe he will talk about this. And I also found that he had a lot of publications. So because of a lot of outstanding award, he also published a lot of outstanding paper. And I remember several years ago when I just came to Yangming University, I heard that there is a native paper. There is a paper published in Nature, and as a famous professor in immunology. And at that time, I know that is Professor Xie Siliang. So he published a famous paper, and he has this famous. He has a lot of these important findings. And recently, I tried to understand his research, and I know that. He has a lot of important observation and findings on decoy receptor. And recently, he also has published a lot of important findings on lectins, on the role of immunity or immune cells. So these are his recent research interests. So I think if you miss today's lecture, that's your loss.And let's welcome our distinguished speaker.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Begin my talk, I would like to thank Professor Lian's kind and comprehensive introduction about myself. Today, the topic of my talk is we discuss discuss a very interesting protein called myelolectin, and to convince you how important of a lectin in the pathogenesis of many human diseases. This is my most favorite cartoon drawn by my students. For immunologists, the most important issue is how immune system recognize such diverse of antigens, including the pathogen, the tumor, and some endogenous danger signal we call mitochondrial DNA or activated extracellular vesicle from the platelets. And in order to sense all the danger signal, our innate immune system, we call myeloid cell, they express abundant of innate immunity receptor in the sensor. So they can sense the intrusion of many danger signal. So they can activate and trigger inflammatory reaction. So today, many people working on infectious disease like cytokine storm, immune thrombosis, or they cause a chronic infection, or even a cancer invasion, or all the immune disease. All these events comes from the recognition of a danger signal by all the innate immunity receptor sensor. So this is something I'm interested. In addition, Professor Lian just mentioned, after the inflammation, we want to get the tissue repairing, we call regeneration, rather than fibrosis. So these two issues for my lifelong research. And the purpose is we hope we'll be able to generate antibody or small molecule to block the interaction between the danger signal and the innate immunity receptor so we can cure the disease. So this is the reason one. The second one is I try to identify interesting protein which can switch the macrophage differentiation from pro-inflammatory macrophage into tissue repairing macrophage. And due to the time limits, today I will focus on the first part. It's how receptor, this lectin receptor recognize so many pathogen. Okay. And my research, I changed from tissue repairing to inflammation. Actually, it's due to the first SARS attack happened in year 2003. At that time, in year 2003, Taiwan is attacked by the SARS infection. So at that time, the Su Yizhen, he's the CDC director. He called me, he said, okay, Dr. Xie, you are immunologist, so would you please give a talk about how virus triggers cytokine storm? At that time, I was still young. I think cytokine storm so important, and I have the main line. So I just spent overnight, find some references and read the paper, and I can give a presentation to tell you how virus triggers cytokine storm. But in the night, I begin to regret because I find the information is so limited and I cannot find the answer from the published literature. So this is the first inspiration to let me think how virus can trigger severe inflammation like cytokine storm. And then in SARS-CoV-2, we know in addition to cytokine storm, they also cause platelet aggregation, cause thrombosis. So this is another challenge. While SARS-CoV-2, they are structurally similar, but they can trigger immune thrombosis. The other virus I'm interested in is the flavivirus, and the representative one is the dengue. You know that we have dengue outbreak in Tainan and Kaohsiung. And dengue infection, they have completely different clinical symptoms. They have hemorrhagic fever, they have shock syndrome, and for JEV, they cause neuroinflammation. For Zika, they can cause orchitis. But clinical symptoms completely different. In addition to acute infection, they have some virus that will cause a chronic infection, like a Hep B. We know hepatitis B is one of the most famous disease for Chinese people, especially in Taiwanese. Many people suffer from a chronic infection, and they have caused a tolerance because in a patient, you can find this abundant viremia in the blood. But the chronic hepatitis patient, they just cannot produce antibody against certain antigen. So it's still a mystery now, still no clear answer until our recent work. I'll give you some, share some light on this direction. Okay. So the first question is how virus can activate or suppress immune system and leading cytokine storm and immune tolerance. So 15 years ago, when I raised this question, and many people, they are so knowledgeable, they read a lot of books about all the DNA sensor, all the toll receptor. They told me, okay, Dr. Xie, this is a well-known story. You can, because all the virus can trigger toll receptor and cause inflammatory reactions. But I'm not satisfied with this result. The first one, the first evidence is all the virus, they have nucleic acid, either DNA or RNA. If the pathway is the answer, then all the virus will trigger similar pathway, they have similar symptoms. So this cannot answer why some virus can trigger immune suppression, why some virus can trigger immune thrombosis. So apparently, this pathway, even though it's very important for virus-induced interferon to provide protected immune response, but this pathway cannot tell you why some virus can trigger cytokine storm and why some virus can trigger inflammatory reaction. So at that time, there's no answer and no any clue to tell you how to approach these questions. Okay. So I raised a hypothesis. The virus maybe can act like a ligand to stimulate the innate immune receptor on the myeloid cell. And why I focus on myeloid cell, because the myeloid cell including many important cells, for example, the macrophage. And macrophage is a major source of cytokine. And we know the myeloid cell also including the platelets. And platelets activation will cause immune thrombosis. And for the neutrophil, when neutrophil overactivated, they can produce the net formation. So it's highly possible that the virus can interact with this innate cell, we call myeloid cell, and trigger a very kind of immune responses. So this is my hypothesis. Okay. Some audience may be not familiar with immunology, so I had a brief introduction about the function of the macrophage. The macrophage is the most important immune cell in our body. After activation, they can secrete a lot of cytokine. We call pro-inflammatory cytokine. So for example, they can induce IL-1 beta, and IL-1 beta is the most important endogenous pyrogen to cause fever. So when virus can activate macrophage, they would reduce IL-1 beta and trigger high fever, and they also can create a lot of pro-inflammatory cytokine. So apparently, it's highly possible virus can stimulate the macrophage induce inflammatory reaction. But the question is how? The second one is the neutrophil. Neutrophil is a very unique cell because the morphology is distinct from the most cell. They have a polymorph nucleus. And when I was a student, I don't understand why this cell is so strange. Their nucleus is not round shape. And they have a multiple lobe. And now we understand when macrophage, when neutrophil is overactivated, they will have the nucleus with decondensation. So it means there will be dissociation between the histone and the DNA. And the DNA will be released from the nucleus to the neighboring region. And so this is very unique structure we call NETs formation, neutrophil, actual cellular traps. It's including the histone, DNA, and many nuclear components. And why NET is so important? Even early stage showing that NET have provide some protective effect in host defense against bacterial infection, but the overproduction of NETs will also cause the blood occlusion, and also cause IL-1 overproduction and cause a lot of immune disease. So when neutrophil is overactivated, the excessive net formation can cause many diseases, including autoimmunity. And the third one is the platelets. When I was medical students, we know platelets are important for hemostasis, 止血作用. But most people don't understand is that the platelets also express abundant of innate immunity receptor. For all the receptor you can find in leukocyte, you can also find in platelets. Now in COVID-19, we understand many people get infected or even after infection, we call it long COVID. They have a lot of neurological problems because they have microemboli circulating in the blood. So before we have vaccination, many people die of immunothrombosis. So apparently during the SARS-CoV-2, the platelets also overactivated. Okay. So I tried to identify the potential receptor and the sensor. So I make an extensive review. I found, in addition to the toll-like receptor and the endosomal sensor, the myeloid cell have expressed abundant so-called ITAM, cis-coupled C-type lectins. These receptors are responsible for the activation of the immune system. In addition, they also express abundant so-called cyclic-3-related lectins. And this lectin, in contrast to the ITAM motif, they contain the ITIM motif, which is similar to a very important immune checkpoint receptor, PD-1. However, even up to now, very few information to tell you what's the function of the cyclic family in human disease. So in order to resolve this question, I just happened met Dr. Wong Qihui. Wong Qihui, at that time, he won't recruit me to Academia Sinica. So I bring this idea, and he said, oh, it's a very interesting idea. It's a good idea. Then I just smile and watch at him. And then 1 minute later, he understand what I mean. Because I tell him I need this. I need money. We spent almost 1.5 years. We get a lot of fresh blood from the blood bank. We culture into the dendritic cell and we clone the gene from all the differential cell and fuse with FC portion to make a fusion protein one by one. So finally, I generate almost 30 fusion proteins. So after I have this lectin receptor, then I'll be able to immobilize on the plate and incubate with the all kind of virus. Then I can detect which receptor can bind the particular virus. Okay, so it will be the solution to find how virus can trigger innate immunity receptor. And the more important is in Academia Sinica, we have very good phage display library. There's many experts can generate good antibodies. So my colleague will help me to generate a human antibody against the receptor. So this library will allow me to pick up all the human antibody capable of block interaction and have the potential for therapeutic purpose. Okay. So today my talk will include two main directions. The first one is I use the viral infection to tell you how important of this receptor. In the second part, I will introduce the function of this receptor in bacterial infection, especially is the IL-23 and IL-17 mediated disease. Okay. When I clone all the gene and ready for detection, and SARS is gone. So I don't know how to perform the experiments. You know, for immunology, we produce a lot of weapon, but we need an enemy. So I'm wondering what kind of virus can test and prove my the hypothesis. And I found dengue will be the perfect target because dengue is an endemic disease. endemic disease. And in Taiwan, many people working on dengue infection. And dengue has caused many strange and unique clinical symptoms. For example, when people get a dengue infection, you get high fever. And you get extremely pain sensation. So dengue also known as a breakbone disease. This is unique. This never happened in other viruses. In addition, they can also cause dengue hemorrhagic fever. So this is a very diverse clinical symptom, but mainly is the pain sensation. So how dengue virus trigger pain sensation is unknown before my study. The second interesting part is during the dengue infection, if you examine the change of the leukocyte, you will find almost all the cells are activated. The platelets are activated, neutrophils are activated, especially is the macrophage, because the dengue will infect macrophage and trigger inflammatory reaction. So after we get all the fusion protein, we use a dengue as an example, and we are very lucky to find three receptors which can interact with the dengue virus. The first two is the DC9 and DC9R. These have been reported, so we are very happy. These are like an endogenous positive control. But what I'm interested in is to find the dengue virus can also interact with the CLK5A specifically, even though the signal is weaker. But however, these two receptors, DC9 and DC9R, cannot transduce signal. And the CLK5A is an ITAM-containing receptor. So I think it's highly possible the virus can trigger inflammatory reactions through CLK5A. And we also use the sugar commutation assay to demonstrate that the interaction is through the sugar, the virus glycan and the CLK5A interaction, because we can use the glycosidase to remove the sugar, or we can use the fucose for computation to prove the interaction is through the sugar and the lectin interaction. So, and we also generate the antibody. This antibody generated by Chen Shiting 老师, and we prove in the mouse model when we had inject the mice with the broken antibody, we can prevent the hemorrhagic fever in the mouse model. And this is a quantitative assay, and it's not only inhibit plasma leakages, it also increased the survival rate up to 50%. So at that time, this is the brand new idea, and this is the first example showing the virus can trigger surface receptor and cause inflammatory reaction. And we are very lucky when we publish the paper, it's not only published in the prestigious journal, it also reported in the international media. So this one is the UK Telegraph, and this one is the Berlin Daily. Professor Lin Zhengzhang can read it. Actually, I cannot read it. What I can recognize, they mention the keyword, they call CLK5A. And these are the Fa Xin Se, the AFP. And it's also in Russian languages, and that means, and also in Spanish. So many countries report our finding. So it's a very, so when we publish a paper, we think, okay, the hard working, we get the reward. So we are very happy that our idea and concept has been accepted and also recognized. So after that, I want to understand how dengue can trigger and cause the bone pain. And I found when you incubate the dengue with the osteoclast, you can induce osteoclast activation. And this not only happened in vitro, in a mouse model, we found after the dengue infection, and if you check the CTX1 by ELISA, CTX1 is the digestion fragment from the collagen. So when osteoclast highly activated, they will digest the bone and release CTX1. And you can find this transient increase of the CTX1 during the dengue infection. In the mouse model, we also use a micro pad to examine the bone structure, and you can find after dengue infection, there's a change in the bone mass loss. And this phenomenon can be treated by broken antibody clarifier. So this data to show that the dengue, one of the mechanisms to cause the bone pain is highly possible related to the unique ability of dengue to stimulate osteoclasts and to cause the bone homeostasis disturbance. So in addition to dengue, we are also working on the JAV and Zika and H5N1. So all the data suggests the virus can interact with the C-type lectin clarifier. But people will challenge why this receptor can recognize so many viruses. So the answer is the virus glycan contain different sugar. They have salicylic acid, have mannose, have fucose. So the clarifier not work alone. The clarifier will form with heto complex with the DC sign and mannose receptor, so they can capture the different kind of virus through the glycan lectin interaction. And clarifier is the only receptor with the depth tail and ITA motif. So all the signaling is through the activation of clarifier. The second finding is we know during the informative reaction, NAP3 informants will be activated. But the problem is that NAP3 cannot bind into the virus. So it's still a mystery before our study that how virus trigger NAP3 informant activation. So in our blood paper, we show that dengue can trigger informant activation through the SIG1 and release IL-1 beta and IL-18. So all the flavivirus or H5N1 supports our idea that the virus can trigger surface receptor and cause inflammatory reactions. And the second receptor I would like to introduce is the so-called CDAC2 and CDAC5 total pathway. We found the dengue virus not only activate macrophage. When you incubate the dengue virus with the neutral field, you can find a mild NAP formation. And I just mentioned NAP formation is responsible for the plasma leakages. So we want to understand whether the plasma leakage is through this pathway. However, the NAP formation is not impressive. So my students discussed with me, and I remember in many virus infections, especially in dengue infection, you will cause the thrombocytopenia. So the thrombocytopenia suggests the platelet is also activated. So we decide to co-incubate the neutral field and the platelet together. And you can find this is the robust NAP formation. So suggesting platelets can enhance the NAP formation. And so we further use the antibody to block the effect. And we find the either clarifier antibody or the spontaneous blocker 2 receptor, you can suppress the NAP formation, and you also suppress all the inflammatory cytokine release, including IL-1, IL-6. So suggesting during the dengue infection, platelets also activated, and we perform more study to make sure that the dengue infection can activate platelets through CRAC2. So I use this. More exciting is how platelets can cause NAP formation. And we also get very exciting data. We found when dengue stimulate platelets, the platelets can release an abundance of extracellular vesicles. So if you harvest the extracellular vesicle from the dengue patients, or recently we harvest from the SARS-CoV-2 patient and with a neutral field, using the NTSA, you can find the vesicle size and the amount is increased. Then when you incubate the vesicle with the neutral field, you can cause the NAP formation. And if you use the same vesicle with the macrophage, you also induce cytokine release. And this finding also tell us in our previous study, in our Nature paper, we found the CREG5 only have 50% protection. However, if you block both CREG5 and TOR2, you can increase the survival rate more than 90%. So after 10 years, our initial paper, we found the answer. The dengue not only stimulate one receptor, but also activate CREG2 and subsequently CREG5 and TOR2. Recently, we applied this idea to SARS-CoV-2. When I get the blood sample from the first SARS patients under the permission of Chen Shizhong 部长, I get the permission, so I went to Taoyuan and take the blood from the patients. And we also isolated the vesicle from the patients. And that time is quite dangerous because you have to make sure there's no any virus contamination in patient's blood. And again, if you incubate the vesicle with the macrophage, you do not see obvious the NAM formation. However, if you add the platelets, you can find the NAM formation is more severe than the control group. And in this area, you don't see that the NAM formation is all the nets, there's a robust NAM formation, and they have become aggregated, and they detach from the glass plate. Okay. And we also, to use the CREG2 antibody and to block the interaction. And again, the CREG2 antibody has a potent effect to inhibit the NAM formation. And to further confirm, platelet activation is through the spike protein. We generate a pseudotype virus. The virus only expresses the spike, SARS-CoV-2 spike protein, and we found the pseudotype virus can trigger the NAM formation. So this provides direct evidence. The spike protein can trigger CREG2 activation and induce the NAM formation. And we also performed the ELISA assay. We found all the CDAC2 can interact all the wild type and the variant of SARS-CoV-2 spike protein. So suggesting CREG2 is a novel pattern recognition receptor to SARS-CoV-2 spike proteins. So we want to understand whether we have a way to prevent immune thrombosis. So my students inject the CDAC2 Fc fusion protein in the mouse model. And we found when we inject the CDAC2 Fc fusion protein, this protein has a potent therapeutic effect. It can suppress lung inflammation and immune thrombosis. So we find a pattern, and the company is finding. So we are discussing. We are discussing the potential licensing now. Okay. Even I had many interesting findings in acute virus infection, but this is one question. It's very difficult to use antibody to treat acute viral infection because the window is so small. So we decide to find another potential target. At that time, I have a student from Zhongguo Yiyao Dazhue. He's attending, he's a physician. He's very interested in HPV infection. So he comes to my lecture and he said, okay, Professor Xie, it's possible the Hep B also trigger certain kind of receptor and cause immune suppression. And I say, of course, it's highly possible. And he's very brave. He's a clinician without any basic training. And he decided to take the challenge. So I said, okay, if you're interested, then we should spend more energy and resources on this project. And Hep B is a very interesting virus because they have a typical 40 nanometer dense particle. However, in a patient, in a chronic infected patient, the most abundant antigen is not dense particle. They have a lot of subviral particle, 22 nanometer. And all the subviral particle and the dense particle, they have cytoglycan on the surfaces. So I use my latent array and try to understand whether HBV can bind some of the signal receptor. Okay. And the reason on this project is this happened in the chronic infection patient. If you took the blood from the chronic infected patient, you will find abundant antigen. It means you have lots of antigen in your blood, but you just don't have anybody. And I'm so surprised this more than 40 years, nobody ever tried to understand how HBV suppress immune system. So we decided to answer this question. Okay. After 5 years hard work day and night, I transformed this guy from a clinician become a physician scientist. we use the mass spec and to identify the glycan structure on HPV, and we found all the surface antigen contain the 2,6 cytoglycan on the surfaces. And the binding affinity is very high. If you use the synthetic glycan, the affinity binding is not significant. It's only 10 minus 4 or 10 minus 5. However, if you incubate with the intact virus, the affinity can up to 10 minus 10. So suggesting the HBV, they can form a multiple binding site with the receptor. And after a series of experiments, I used the cartoon to summarize our finding. Our finding is if you incubate the surface antigen with the immune cell, and they can induce inhibitory signal through the Siglec-3, through the ITI motif. And at that time, we are more mature to generate good antibody. So we screened many antibody, and one of antibody we call the 10C8, which is a very good antagonist antibody. So when we incubate the antagonist antibody, we can reactivate immune system and to produce cytokine against the viruses. So this is to tell you the glycan is only expressed on human HBV, but not from HBV from the transgenic mice. So when we publish this paper, many people will be upset because many people working on HEB and use a mouse model. But the mouse is not the natural host of HBV. So this will tell you a very important finding. If you want to basic research, you can use any model you like to prove your concept. However, if you want to treat a disease, you need to use a human sample because the human response is very different from the mouse immune response. So this is lesson one. And we also use the immune presentation to prove the concept. We found only the Siglec-3 can pull down human HBV, and this receptor cannot pull down the mouse, the HBV from the transgenic mice. Okay, so this means what you observe in your transgenic mice is very different from what happened in human body. Okay. So I also repeatedly emphasize the importance of the binding affinity. Even 2,6 cytoglycan can also happen in human cell membrane. However, our cell membrane cannot form a stable complex like HEB. So it means you not only have the sugar also need to be decorated on a very good three-dimensional structure in order to form a stable structure with the to form a binding with Clec5a. Okay, so the 10C antibody is very effective. They can spread the cytokine release when the cell are stimulated with the, they can restore the host immune response to toligans. Okay, this is unpublished data. When we have antibody, the Acadian Clinica, they have a Shenji Yuanqu, so they will encourage the translation research. So we decided to continue to work on this project. So we get the funding, and the only purpose is you need to set up company. You want to push the antibody to become a drug. So under the support of Yunxi Jihua, we took the PBMC from chronic infected patients from hospital, from Rongzhong, from my colleague Huang Yixiang. So we took the peripheral blood and incubate with IL-2 and TOR-7 ligand for 5 days in the presence of CD3. And we're a bit surprised. We can detect the antibody not only on ELISA spot. ELISA spot is very sensitive, but ELISA, the reason you need ELISA spot is because the antibody secretion is so little. So it's hard to detect by conventional ELISA, so you need to use ELISA spot. But we are very surprised, we can detect the antibody just by conventional ELISA assay. So suggesting this antibody is very powerful. They can reactivate our human cell against HBV and stimulate B cell to secrete antibodies. I also collaborate with Chen Peizhe using the hydrodynamic model to prove the potency of this antibody. And you can find in we use two the mice model. As I mentioned, the human CD33 is very different from human. No, the mouse CD33 is very different from human CD33. So if you want to understand the importance of human CD33, you need to knock out mouse endogenous CD3 and put the transgenic human CD33. Okay. So we compare the immune response between the wild type mice and the human CD33 transgenic mice. And you can find, compared to the wild-type mice, the surface antigen expression, as shown in the red color, is lasts longer in the CD33 transgenic mice. So suggesting in the presence of human CD33, they can suppress immune system and maintain the more high level of and longer of surface antigen expression. And in our pilot study, we inject the mouse with the anti-CD33 antibody. We can find the surface antigen going down sharply, quickly. So we continue optimize this system, and we can get a better result now. Okay. So the first summary is, in the past decades, while people are still working on toll-like receptor, I raised a new hypothesis. The virus, of course, they can activate the nucleus sensor to provide the protective immunity. I call the PEM-1. My study provide evidence the virus can also use the surface antigen, either the protein or the glycan. They can activate the myeloid lectin, like CLK5 and CLK2, to stimulate cytokine storm, mitosis, and the immune thrombosis. However, in Hep B, I also prove the HBV can trigger immune suppression through activating the ITIA motif CD3 and downregulate immune system. So currently, the antibody is being transferred to a company, and we want to develop a superior antibody to block the CD3 and the HBV interaction similar to the anti-PD-1 antibody. So we hope that someday, through our effort, we can cure HPV infection in the future. Okay. So any question from my first part? Okay, if no question, I will proceed to the second part, and we can find a discussion. During the virus infection, we also pay attention that the lectin receptor seems to interact with the bacteria as well. Because the most famous lectin receptor we call Datin-1, which is important for fungal infection. But nobody understands whether this lectin receptor also interacts with the bacteria. So under this curiosity, we decided to use the lectin array and probe against the pathogen glycan array. And we found CLK5 also interacts with some bacteria. So we decided to explore the the function of the lectin in bacterial infection. So I will use the listeria and the pseudomonas as an example. Listeria is a very interesting pathogen because the listeria is a gram-positive intracellular bacteria. Okay, I emphasize intracellular is, we know the gram-positive bacteria can stimulate TOR2 on the surface, and the gram-negative bacteria can stimulate TOR4. But the problem is this receptor is similar to dengue virus. They can infect macrophage. So we want to understand what's happening in the intracellular bacteria, how they can trigger inflammatory reaction. And the second interesting observation is from the finding that even TOR2 has been reported can recognize the gram-positive bacteria. However, if you knock out TOR2, there's no any impact on host immune responses. So suggesting this is some yet identified receptor critical in host defense against the TOR receptor. So under this curiosity, we incubate the listeria with the TOR2 knockout mice and to try to understand what's happening. And the result is summarized on this slide. We found when you knock out CRAC2 and CRAC5 and TOR2, both of them, they have certain effect on the killing assay. However, if you perform an NBT assay, the RS production, you will find CRAC5 is more important than TOR2. And if you incubate the bacteria with the neutral field, you can induce the robust net formation. However, if you compare the effect of CRAC5 and the TOR2 antibody, you find that net formation is only inhibited by CRAC5A, but not on TOR2. So suggesting in the bacteria-induced net formation, CRAC5A is far more potent and more important than TOR2. So the conclusion of the study is in the listeria monocytology infection, the listeria can interact not only one receptor, but two receptors. They co-activate TOR2 and CRAC5A. And TOR2 can recognize the lipotetic acid of the gram-positive bacteria. But the CRAC5A will recognize the disaccharide structure on the polysaccharide. So in this listeria infection, they can co-activate two receptors and they have a synergistic effect to trigger the net formation. More excitingly is we found the cultivation of this receptor is very important for gamma IL-17 gamma T cell proliferation. And gamma delta IL-17 secreting cell is very important for intestine immunity against pathogen infection. So the latest study also showing the CRAC5 also critical for an important disease we call inflammatory bowel disease, IBD. So this is also the potential therapeutic agent for IBD in the future. And the second one is Pseudomonas. And why we are interested in Pseudomonas? Pseudomonas is the major cause of nosocomial infection in the hospital. It's an opportunity infection. So in the patient ICU, many people die of Pseudomonas infection. And there's the current antibiotics is not very effective because they easily become drug resistant. The more worse is even you treat it with the antibiotics, and after recovery, the lung also have a severe damage. They have lung fibrosis. So we try to find a way to understand how Pseudomonas trigger inflammatory reaction and whether we can find a way to reduce lung damages. So this result published in the JCI recently, we found among all the receptors, we found that CRAC5 is the most important for Pseudomonas induced net formation. If you knock out the knock out this receptor, you'll find this, the nail formation only severe attenuated in the knockout mice. So, so based on the, all the TOR2, TOR4 and CRPFI knockout mice for the comparison, we get the conclusion that CRPFI is the most important one. In addition, we also check the activation of CAS phase 1 because the activation, the nail formation also through a CAS phase 1 dependent pathway. And we found only CRPFI is responsible for pseudomonas induced the CAS phase 1 cleavage and also critical for all the nail formation. So through the genetic study, we confirm the important role of CRPFI in bacterial infections. So the summary of our finding is when you encounter the pseudomonas infection, they can trigger inflammatory reaction through the alveolar macrophage and the neutrophil. The neutrophil will produce a bundle of net formation and cause lung injury. In addition, they can activate the CAS phase 1 in the macrophage and release IL-1 to cause the tissue damages. So when we combine the antibiotics and the broken antibody, it's not only inhibit inflammatory reaction, they can also enhance the bacterial clearance. So hopefully this will become a novel approach to prevent, to treat bacterial infection in the future. So people may get confused. The consequence of activation of CRPFI and TOR2. In this serial infection, our conclusion is this pathway is very important to provide protective mechanism against infection. However, in dengue infection, in JV infection, and SARS-CoV-2, the activation of this pathway actually become detrimental. Okay, so this is something I'd like to deliver is we encounter so many pathogens, and the reason we have immune system is try to protect us. So when you trigger this receptor by listeria, this mechanism is very effective. They can trap the listeria spreading, they can kill listeria. So this is a successful inflammatory reaction, and this is why listeria is not so toxic. Listeria is an opportunistic infection. However, when the same receptor activated by other pathogen, you cause a lot of inflammatory reaction, but this immune response actually is futile. It's not effective to control the virus infection. Okay. So this is a very important idea, is whether activation of this pathway is helpful or is it detrimental. It depends on your enemy, the nature of your enemy. So this is something I'd like to emphasize, and also an important finding in my previous work. Okay, so what will we do in the coming 5 years? Okay, the first one is based on our finding, we try to test whether the bispecific antibody generated in my laboratory is a potential for treatment of SLE or not. And why we have this brave and this such kind of hypothesis is because in the SLE, it's well known, in SLE patients, they have excessive nail formation. And the nail formation will release the DNA and the histone, so they can induce immune response to generate autoantibody against the DNA, against the histone. So this is the most important nail formation associated with autoimmunity. So we generate antibody and we isolate the vesicle from the SLE patients. And this has been reported that in SLE patients, the EV, the HSC vesicle, is abundant. It's far more than healthy control. And this further study also suggests the vesicle is from activated platelets. So we are very excited about this finding. So we get the vesicle from SLE patient and incubate with a neutral field, and we can find it can induce a robust nail formation. However, if you treat it with the calcified antibody, as shown in the gray color, or by the calcified bispecific antibody, all the nail formation was suppressed. So suggesting in SLE, one of the most important dangerous signals may come from the platelet-derived HSA vesicle. So we using more sample to prove this idea, and this potential for SLE treatment in the future. This idea also supported by recent study published by our colleague Wei Yaohui 老师。Wei Yaohui 老师, you know, he's very famous for mitochondria DNA study. So he compared and analyzed the DNA level, mitochondrial DNA and the nuclear DNA from SLE patient. Again, he get a conclusion that the DNA can trigger the nail formation and through the clarify and the blockade clarify is highly possible to induce the nail formation. So this is something the potential implication in the future. The second one is associated with autoimmune arthritis, rheumatoid arthritis, or the bone erosion. In addition to our work, to our study, another group in the United States showing the collagen-induced autoimmune arthritis can be inhibited by calcified antibodies. So suggesting calcified, again, is very important in the bone erosion, as what we observe in the dengue infections. And this is my colleague I met in Boston 2 weeks ago. He's very interested in IL-23. IL-23 is upstream to IL-17. And he found that IL-23 can stimulate calcified positive osteoclast precursor to cause the bone erosion. So this further suggests calcified is important in osteoclast activation and bone erosion. So suggesting they have the potential to inhibit osteoporosis. And this finding is further supported by another interesting paper showing in the IBD. You know, some of the IBD patients or people, they have severe intestinal inflammation. And for some reason, they become a bone erosion and bone osteoporosis without knowing the reason. And they have interesting finding. They're using either the DSS or adult T-cell transfer or using a famous bacterial model, Citrobacter rhodinin infection, to induce IBD. And they find for all the three different models, they can induce the calcified positive osteoclast cell activation. And when they inject the antibody, they can inhibit bone erosion. So suggesting the calcified also important in intestinal inflammation and the bone osteoporosis. Finally, I'd like to extend my research to cancer. You know, the cytoglycan, the cytidase, is not only expressed on HPV surface. In many cancer patients, many cancer cells, in the cancer microenvironment, they express an abundance of cytoglycan. In addition, in the microenvironment, scientists also find an abundant expression of the CD33 or CD33. So it's highly possible in this cancer microenvironment, immune system was suppressed by cytoglycan and the CD33 interaction. So to prove our hypothesis, again, we inoculate the tumor cell into wild-type mice, and the mice expression human CD33. And we get a very striking observation that after inoculation for the same period, you can find in the transgenic mice expression human CD33, the tumor metastasis is a melanoma. So you can easily see the tumor invasion by the color. You can find this early metastasis. And if you observe the survival rate, the human CD33, the mice will die more faster than the wild-type mice. So suggesting the CD33 is a very important immune checkpoint receptor like PD-1 in host defense against viral infection. And so we also generate broken antibody and try to treat and testing their security effect to prevent the cancer. And hopefully they have as potent as a anti-PD-1 or could be a synergistic effect with a PD-1 for cancer therapy in the future. So finally, I'd like to announce what we observe. In Academia Sinica, we not only encourage the basic research, we also encourage the translational research. So if you are interested to generate a superior antibody, I will tell you what we can do in the laboratory. What we observe, when you publish paper in Nature, it means you may you find the potential targets. And you also use a mouse model to get the mouse monoclonal antibody not optimized. And you prove it, and you can publish the paper in Nature. However, to become a drug, you have a long way to go. You need to find good protein chemists to optimize your antibody and make sure they can express abundantly in the CHO cell. And you need to make a CMC structure and, of course, the humanization. Then you go to the cell line selection. So you need from here to here, you need at least another $30 million to go to this step. Then after the cell line selection, there's nothing you can do. What you need is at least $20 million New Taiwan dollars. So, so my company is trying to license all the important finding, and Academia Sinica can support us to this step. So after this step, we translate our license to find a good partner to local or international company to become a drug. So we can get the money and focus on drug discovery, and we don't have to spend too much effort for the further development, because it's nothing we can do. It's, it will be done by the industry, but not in the laboratory. So I would like to use this slide to make an announcement. We, in Academia Sinica, we have a so-called National Biotechnology Research Park. And in this area, we focus not on basic research. In this area, is we want to put money, and today you have a chance to prove your finding is something could be translated to become a therapeutic agent. So if you are interested in this work, we hope we welcome the student and postdoctor to join my research team. In addition, I would like to inform you a very important progress recently. I took your vice president, Yang Menghua, with me to Harvard University. We signed a MOU, three parties, between Harvard Jinlei Institute, Yangming Jiao Tong Dazhue, and NHGRI. And we will focus on cancer immunology and immune aging and immune metabolism. So hopefully through this platform, you will be able to exchange with the Harvard University. And this is the way we try to cultivate the young scientist through this channel in the future. Okay, I would like to thank all, I would like to thank all my collaborator and the students, especially President Wong Qihui, for his kind support. Just give me the money and just listen to my idea without showing him any evidence. Okay, and I like this picture. There's a English science is a common memory for all the young in Jiao Tong Da Xue students. Okay, thank you.
Okay, I think in my introduction, I forgot to mention that actually Professor Yi is a physician scientist. Now, from his talk, you can understand now. And also from his talk, I think now you hear about a lot of money and also a lot of paper. He published a lot of paper, a lot of this basic knowledge, fundamental research, a lot of paper. So it's really a very enjoyable talk, a very fabulous talk, and you can really, I think it's not very common that in one talk we can listen to so many stories and publish in many papers. So now I think now there are many questions from you. So if you have any question, please raise your hand.
Yeah. Okay, hold on.
So thanks for a very fantastic talk. I learned a lot from the C-type Latin. So I know C-type Latin is a very huge family, right?
Yeah.
I'm not an expert about that. But I'm curious, I have two questions. So first one, I'm just curious whether the C-type team receptor expression pattern have a tissue specific expression pattern. And the question is because I also saw some papers study about the C-type Latin 7A also can activate the SYK pathway to have some positive effect to clean up the A-beta deposition the next year. I saw the cell papers. And the second question is, so for the pro-inflammatory like macrophage or the anti-inflammatory macrophage, they can, whether they have a heterogeneity expression pattern of the C-type
leptin
receptor expression pattern, or they don't have.
Okay. Okay. I answer the second question because it's easier. Yeah, you are right. The expression of clarify is quite there's a differential expression in different macrophage subset. One of the basic example is what we published in the broad paper in year 2013 is. When we use the MCSF and the GMCSF to culture the macrophage from the same donor, then you incubate with the dengue, you find the monocyte derived, no, MCSF derived monocyte would not produce any IL-1. However, if you incubate with the GMCSF derived macrophage, you can find the robust IL-1 production. Okay. So, and of course, the clarify expression is also quite different. So that this is the first question. The clarify expression is quite, this is a differential expression in different cell type. And for the A-beta, this is also something I'm interested in. I have a collaboration with Zheng Hanru Lao Shi. The SYK receptor is very important in the pathogenesis of Alzheimer's disease. For example, there's a famous one called TREM2. And if somebody producing TREM2 antibody try to treat Alzheimer's disease. But for genetic linkages, I, as a physician scientist, I more trust genetic linkages because it clearly tell you the disease associated with certain disease. And I would like to tell you, in addition to APOE, the second strong association is a clarify. It's a, many people don't, and there's, CD33, sorry, it's another story. The most protective allele is associated with CD33. And because CD33 is a negative, its function is opposite to TREM2. TREM2 is causing inflammatory, so you want to block TREM2. But for the SYK3, is also associated with the Alzheimer's disease. So the hypothesis is, for Alzheimer's disease, they have abundant cytoglycan in the brain, just similar to what we observe in the cancer microenvironment. So if you have antibody, you have antagonist antibody, you can trigger the microglia activation. to enhance their ability to clear the beta amyloid, and you can treat the disease. So you don't need neutralization. And if you increase the phagocytosis, the advantage is not only uptake beta amyloid, they can also uptake the soluble hyperphosphorylated tau protein. So they will potentially bring more beneficial effect by activating CK3. So this is something we are testing, and we are collaborating with Zheng Han Ruo 老师 for this study. And recently, there's a paper using a similar approach like us. They induce the injured beta, they use a beta amyloid changing mice and compare their effect in the wild type mice and the mice expressing human CD33. And the evidence tell you very strongly that what we observe in the cancer, if you overexpress the beta amyloid in human CD33 changing mice, their disease will become even worse. So suggesting in the past, many people ignore the potential function of this lectin receptor to regulate immune system. And the big hurdle is cytolectin is easier because it's highly conserved between human and mouse. But for cigarette, it's very complicated because the human CD33 function is distinct from the mouse CD33. So that's why this field, the progression is so slow because you need to generate, you have to knock in human cigarette one by one and to generate good mouse model to answer the question. So this is what I tell you, if you want to prove a concept, science principle, any model is fine. But if you want to treat a human disease, then you should be very careful to decide which model can most mimic what happened in human. So that's why I always insist, as an immunologist, I always a human peripheral blood, or use the mouse bone marrow cell. I never use the cell line, because what you observe in cell line is very different from what happened in the primary cell. Yes.
Okay, very nice talk. So my question is about something that you actually just touched upon. So the cyclic 3, right? It is a big family of receptors, and they all recognize sialic acid. So what is, I guess, the special thing about cyclic 3, because all the other family members, they also recognize the same thing, they signal the same way. So is it like the most abundantly expressed, or is it expressed on the right cells so that it can basically suppress the immune response to, I guess, both hepatitis, cancer? So what's the secret there?
Okay. This is where we have lectures talking about human glycobiology. Cytoglycan, actually, they have different linkages. For example, we know the sialic acid can link the last lectures by 2-3 linkages or 2-6 linkages. So when you're talking about the specificity, I'll tell you different cyclic, they bind, their specificity is distinct. So for example, CD33 preferentially bind to 2-3 linkages, but has less affinity to 2-6 linkages. And in addition, there's many modifications. For example, they have sulfation or other fucosylation of the cytoglycan. So actually, the cytoglycan structure is very complicated. It's heterogeneous. So that's why we need so many different kinds of cyclic. So this is the first one. The second one is the cyclic. Different cyclic expressed on different cell type. For example, some cyclic preferentially expressed in the eosinophil. So people which target the cyclic 3 in the eosinophil, no, cyclic 7 in the eosinophil try to treat the allergic disease. Okay, so this is our answer question. The first one is a cyclic family, even though it's an abundant family, but they express different cyclic expressed on different cell type. The second one is each cyclic, they have a unique specificity to bind to a particular cytoglycan.
And if I can follow up a little bit on the same question, so different siglecs recognize slightly different versions of sialic acid, right? So would you predict that then there will be diseases that will respond to, let's say, blocking of other family members of the CD33?
This is the most difficult part, and this is our advantages. For all the siglec family, all the glycan specificity you observe is based on synthetic glycan. So all the, because maybe our JCI paper is a false paper to show the authentic the ligand of CD33. Because all the specificity is based on synthetic glycan. So that's why I show the slide to tell you the affinity between the synthetic glycan and the cyclic is very low. So the margin is very low. So I doubt the result based on the synthetic glycan. And so this is the question. Because even we have some information, but I'll tell you it's based on synthetic oligomer. So you have to be skeptical whether what the textbook tell you is true or not. And the second one is if you want to generate good superiority body, you need to use a similar approach like us, because we find Hep B, and Hep B have high affinity to the receptor. So you can use this as a functional assay to screen a good antibody to block the injections. Okay. So that hopefully this can answer your questions.
Thank you.
Any question? HBB.
So what's the tissue distribution of CD33? Is it highly expressed?
It's a more complicated issue. When you check the gene expression, it's based on so-called healthy control. All the data in the database, most are based on healthy control. So if you check the literature, they will tell you the CD33 only expressed on myeloid cell, which is a macrophage dendritic cell. Okay. But our recent study find the CD33 not only in myeloid cell, at least in the chronic hepatitis patient, CD33 also upregulated in B cell. It's something you may be interested in, especially in the atypical memory B cell. And they also express on certain amount of T cell subpopulation. So this is why when we injured anybody just for 5 days in visual culture, we can induce the antibody secretion because it's the target to the atypical memory B cell. So reactivate the B cell to screen antibodies. Okay. So this is a difficult part. When you're talking about the tissue expression, then you have to define is in healthy control or is in disease. In a pathological condition, in Hep B at least, is highly upregulated in the B cell, a typical memory B cell, in a certain subpopulation of T cell.
So, does anyone understand where the CD33 is upregulated in certain pathological conditions, in addition to the chronic?
There's only one paper showing CD33 is upregulated in like a leukemia or something. So I'll tell you, if you walk on this field, you don't have to worry that is when you wake up and somebody published a paper. Because it's very difficult, most people don't understand, especially even for the immunologist. Very few immunologists understand the function of cyclic. And most of the people working on cyclic, they are biochemists. They are not immunologists. So you have a good advantage. When you work on this field, then you don't have a competitor because most people don't understand the importance of glycan.
Yes, we have. I guess we have students from Institute of Microbiology and Immunology, right? Students, right? We need to have some questions from students. No? Our students are very quiet. I mean, more questions from our faculty members.
I have a question about the immune suppressions.
As you said, there are some particles, but however, the patient did not induce the antibodies. Therefore, you call it immune suppressions. But also, there are many female patients has antibodies against BBB. So how can they pass? How can those patients with antibody against BBB bypass the immune suppressions?
Yeah. This is something we don't know. of course, the easiest answer is you tell me the abundance of the antigen, okay? But I think nobody ever have such kind of study because it's a normal finding. So it's very difficult to understand what kind of threshold. But my hypothesis is if initially you get very high viral load, and very high titer antigen in the initial infection status, then it's more possible your immune system is suppressed, okay? But honestly, I don't know. This is a joke, but it's also true. If you are interested in translational research, and the question you're asking is very important, interesting, but they will tell you, okay, ignore it, because it's later the basic scientist to work on this topic. You only identify the most important part, and you try to develop superior antibody and prove this high efficacy and low toxicity. So this for basic research, there's too many interesting questions to ask. But if you want to make a successful drug to prove your finding is significant, then you cannot spend too much effort to all the detailed questions. You only catch up the major question. You develop important security target, security agent, and prove you are right by clinical trial. Yeah.
Okay, good. Any more questions? If not, this thanks Professor Chen again. Oh, okay, sorry, we have one. You
then. Thank you for your very inspiring talk. And because I read some article about the human CD33, and actually I found this actually they have different forms, like major form or minor form. And in Alzheimer's disease, they have a different response about the form. But as for the cancer, is there any difference between major form expression, like level of major form or minor form? Would it be difference between the expression level?
Okay. Do you have the information before my lecture, or you just check the Google?
I read about
okay. You raise a very important question. CD33 is a very interesting molecule because they have polymorphism in the promoter region. So there's a two allele. The major allele, they express the wild type CD33. And if you carry a minor allele, you will find your CD33, the most important domain, the ligand binding domain, is spiced out. Okay. So it's suggesting if you carry the minor allele, then you'll be less suppressed by cytoglycan. And this is very important, and this is why for the GWAS study, they found CD33 is the associated with the Alzheimer's disease. Because based on GWAS study, they found if you carry the minor allele, then you have less chance to get the Alzheimer's disease. Okay, so there's a strong linkage. And again, in our study, for Hep B study, you know, after chronic HBV infection, you will progress into HCC, hepatocellular carcinoma. So in our JCI paper, we don't have any more study. So you're surprised why this paper gets set. because we use that genetic study. According to my hypothesis, if my hypothesis is correct, then in the chronic Hep B patient, if you carry the minor allele, then you have the less chance to progress into HCC. Okay, so I use the Taiwan Day Bank and use my work with my colleague Yang Hua Yi, he's a Chen Jian, the most outstanding student. And he showed a strong linkage. If you have minor allele, then you have the less chance to become HCC after infection. Yeah, so it's very important to understand the allele, what kind of allele you have. So it would be interesting to testing whether for some tumor, I cannot say every tumor, but for at least some tumor overexpressing cytoglycan, then you can compare whether the minor allele patient, they will have the clinical symptoms is not so severe as the wild allele. It would be a very interesting study.
So we have a very good question from students. So may I ask you, which lab are you from? Where do you come from? Irene Lab, that's why.
Oh, okay.
So maybe you are working on this project, right? CD33, okay, yeah. Alzheimer's disease. Okay. So did you take this lecture as a cousin near Miguel Schumann? Do you need to take this lecture? Because you is from Institute of Brain Science. Otherwise, we can give you a bonus. Increase your high grade. Okay. Any more questions for a student? You see, it's a very good example. No? Okay. So now we prepare what do we have? Appreciation of this certificate, and also we have gift. Okay. So now let's thank Professor Xie again. So okay. We need to take a picture.
Okay. Thank you. 我们在这里吗？还是这样？ 在上面。
这次在纪念马街路上抽的，其实最后一家，
所以他最后会中文这么好？不是，他连文都，他有英文版，都翻得不错，这翻得不错。